open sleigh.
Today.
O'er the fields we go.
Toodle.
Laughing all the way.
Today. Bells on bobtail ring, making our spirits bright.
What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Dashing through.
We're going to go through it again. I like it. A little bit. No. Man, first of all, I want before you go. First of all, you guys wonder every week the worship team, they come first gathering and they worship and then they do second and then they leave. They're not just coming and leaving. They come first. But I want to tell you, worship team, you did an awesome job. I'd ask for that song, right? Rattle is one of my favorite songs. Every time I'm in a place I just need to hear and feel God moving, I listen to that song. It's a powerful song. And so a couple of months ago, I said, Andrew, I want us to play this song. I go, all right, that's a challenge. I guess there's some real like guitar changes and stuff. And they did it 2 weeks ago when we were sick. And I'm like, no. He's like, no worries. I'm going to do it again this week. It was phenomenal, man. Didn't you hear the word of the Lord in that song, man? Thank you for leading us into the throne room to worship the Lord. Thank you, guys. Yeah, so. Man, that gets me fired up. Whew. All right. I'm going to get fired up more, so let's calm down for a moment here. All right, so Christmas is coming, right? Y'all with me? I got a little survey. Who has completely finished their shopping? Raise your hand. I'm done shopping. I'm complete. All right, I see you. All right, good. Who says I haven't even started yet? All right, am I out here? All right, I see you. All right. Well, the good news is, regardless of whatever your plans are, if you got still shopping to do, or you can just rest the rest of the time because all your shopping is done, then here's the thing. We want you to come Christmas Eve. We are having a celebration. So you guys kind of pick up on the name itself. We don't do a Christmas Eve gathering. And the reason is on purpose, because you know, one of our core values at Radius is we believe that a relationship is the fiber of Radius. We really do. We think the strength of the church is in relationship. And sometimes that means it doesn't happen in a church, is to be with your family. And so what I ask is that you come on the night before, right? Maybe you have stuff for your family. I know growing up I did. So we do Christmas Eve right here. We have two times, 7 or 8 o'clock. And 7 o'clock will be about 45 minutes long, either one. So come join us. It's going to be a great night. We're going to celebrate the Christmas story. We're going to move through and worship. It's going to be really awesome. I hope you come and join us. It'd be a great way to just really get your heart focused on the truth and what Christmas is all about, right? That's kind of where we're at in our series, Making Spirits Bright. We've been looking at this idea, been looking at the celebration, the season of Advent. And Advent is what in Latin we learned was the arrival or the coming of Jesus, right? And we've been focusing on that because Christmas, there's so much there, man. You might love a good Christmas cookie. I love a good Christmas cookie. Come on, right? Christmas tree decorations, all of the things that are Christmas, I love. But these are the things that they die out. They may deal with a little down, like feeling down after Christmas. Anybody with me? Like the light, the neighborhood seem darker, the trees are down, the Christmas gifts are all unwrapped. And I almost have this feeling sometimes, I feel this down because I realize that this season, all the things around it really aren't the source of true joy and peace, right? They happen for a moment, and yes, I love them. I love being with family. I love having Christmas dinner. All these things I love, and they bring aspects of joy and peace and love, but they really aren't the heart of it. What the true heart of the Christmas story is, the heart is Jesus. And we're looking at him and his arrival and looking at Advent and how each week we looked at Advent of love and of joy, and saw how these things can last year round. And today, we're going to finish our series by looking at the last one, which is peace. Oh, man. Peace is a thing that is, in short, is not, we don't have a lot of it nowadays, it seems like, don't you? Maybe you're here today and you don't have peace in your marriage. Maybe you're struggling with your marriage and your situation, and there's no peace. Maybe it's in your job. Maybe it's with your finances. Maybe it's with your children. We look at society, we look around us, peace is not as available as we want it. And this is the message for you, because peace comes not from a position, it doesn't come from a lack of struggle, it comes from a person. And we're going to look at that story today, we're going to look at peace. I'm going to go ahead, I just need to stop, I need to pray, because I just feel the Holy Spirit in my mind. I need to resync my heart with Jesus right now. So would you join me in prayer? Lord Jesus, God, help sync my soul back to your words. Help me to hear and speak exactly what you say to this people today. God, help me to honor you and lift you up and really speak about the peace that only comes from you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I find it interesting in a series that we celebrate peace, it seems like Christmas time is where we don't experience peace, right? It gets busy. Y'all with me? The joke is after Thanksgiving, it kind of just speeds up. Y'all with me? And all of a sudden, it's like New Year, first day of the year, and you're like, what? That was a blur, right? There's so much going on. And peace is something that we don't experience in the very season that celebrates it. Because truly Christmas, if the bell rings of anything, it is that there is peace on earth. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, a famous American poet and scholar, wrote a poem called Christmas Bells. And in it, he celebrates and talks about these bells as the messengers of peace. It says in the first, I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play. Wild and sweet, their words repeat, of peace on earth and goodwill to men. And thought how as that day had come, the belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. This is no more true than in 1915 in the Great War. In World War I, as we know, and there was much conflict in the world. It was known as the Great War, there was violence, there was death, and there was the whole world at war with each other. And on 1915, on Christmas Day, a German soldier wrote in his diary about what had happened. He said, we were fighting with the French on the French border, and on Christmas morning, all of a sudden, the bells began to ring in the village near. He said, the most unmilitary, fascinating thing happened. As the bells were ringing, the shots became less and less until there was a sudden silence over the battlefield. And he said, as he wrote and intended to share the story, he said, as we sat there in silence, soldiers began to get up out of the foxholes and actually met together in the middle of the field. This is a documented thing. They began to exchange gifts and actually spent the day singing Christmas carols together. Powerful. The proclamation of peace and the ringing of the bell overshadowed the sound of war. And that declaration of peace was no stronger than that was the first night when the angels sung with the bells of heaven, declaring the peace of God had come to man. Luke chapter 2, we had looked at it last week. Luke chapter 2, verse 13. Suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others. I love it. The first part, there's just one angel talking about Jesus coming. Then he needs the whole choir of heaven to sing about what's going to happen next. He says, and the armies of heaven praising God and saying, verse 14, glory to God in the highest heaven, peace on earth to those whom God is pleased. It was that night when Jesus was born in a baby in a manger that peace came to earth. Now, if you look at the Greek word for peace here, it's not a feeling of peace. We all think that peace is a feeling. It's something I can just feel about. And sometimes we think peace is the absence of conflict. But if you look at the Greek word for peace here, it actually means united, one. It carries the context in the Greek of being brought together. Why the angels of heaven, the whole army had to come sing, was that finally God had come and dwelt among man, that through Jesus we'd be reunited with the Father. We'd be one again. This is where peace comes from. You see, this is what we need to talk about today, because many of us are not experiencing peace in our life. Maybe we have conflict with a spouse and we feel there's no peace. Maybe we have conflict with a boss or with a friend. Maybe we have no peace on the inside of us. May we look at our finances. May we look at our future. May we look at the worries around us, and we don't have a sense of peace. What the angel was proclaiming that night, regardless of the circumstances, Jesus come that he can be here with us, because peace is not a feeling. It's not an absence of conflict. It is a position that I step in, that God is near. See, when Henry Wadsworth Longfellow wrote that poem, he actually wrote that poem in 1863, right in the middle of the Civil War. Conflict, and his own son had been injured and didn't know if he was going to make it. So as he's writing the hearing the bells on Christmas morning, in the middle of conflict, he hears and knows the message of peace, but he kind of shares more of his heart as he looks at the next stanza. And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said. For hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Maybe that's where you're at today. Maybe you hear, yes, we're going to sing about the peace of God and we sing about his greatness, but your life, with the circumstances, the things that are surrounding you, seem to mock this hope of peace. But Henry Wadsworth Longfellow understands there's something deeper than just the circumstances. The next verse, he says this. The stanza says, then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. Wrong shall fail and right prevail. Peace on earth and goodwill to men. He proclaims, and a couple weeks ago we talked about confess, right? Confession is proclaiming what's true about what God says instead of how we feel. And he is confessing at that moment, yes, I look around me and my circumstances, my marriage, my job, my kids, the things in my life, I don't feel peace, I'm not seeing peace, but there is because one reason that God came to earth, that he drew near, that he, because of what Jesus Christ came and then ultimately died and rose from the dead, he positioned me to be able to step into peace. This is the message today. If you want to kind of close down with this, I will tell you right now, peace has been offered to each of us through Jesus. And you may not feel it, and your circumstances may not say it, but you have been offered the opportunity to step into a place of peace, and as a place where God is near. See, this is why he came. This is why the angel is saying, peace on earth. Why? Because peace himself had descended. In Isaiah 6:9, we're going to jump out of rhythm here, Isaiah from First Gathering. Isaiah 6:9, when the prophecy in Isaiah is proclaimed about this coming Messiah one day, this is how they announce him. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and everybody say it with me, Prince of Peace. You know what he was saying in that moment? He is the one that has the authority to give peace in any situation. That's interesting. Go back to Luke 14 because God has offered us peace, but there is a very fundamental truth that each of us must understand of how we step into the peace. And I'm really going to just lay it on the bottom shelf because I don't know about you, but I need it very practical. How do I step into this peace? Let's go back to verse. I'm actually going to, the last part of the verse is, and peace on earth, I'm sorry, you were right, I was wrong. Verse 14, get all excited. Peace on earth to those whom God is pleased. Now, some of us say, I wish he wouldn't have put that last part on there, right? There's peace on earth. I mean, I don't know if God's pleased with me, right? There is good news. This is why they're proclaiming. Who is God pleased with? God is pleased with anyone who chooses to accept him. You see, Romans chapter 3, and verse, I believe, 22 says that we are made right, made at peace with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who you are. Let me make it very clear. God has offered each of us peace, regardless of our circumstance, but we have the opportunity, we must choose to step into it. I mean, every Sunday we sing songs about God's power. That's one of my favorite songs, Rattling, right? God can bring dry bones to life. Don't you wish you might have dry bones in your marriage, in your workspace? And you say, why aren't you doing something? God says, I need you to choose to step into the position. You know what that looks like? That is surrender. That is saying, I give up. I'm not choosing my way any longer. I am choosing to surrender myself in position to you. You see, my life does not have peace when I try to do it my own way. Y'all with me? When I try to make it happen, when I try to figure it out, when I am stressed and try to scheme and figure out how I'm going to make it work, the feeling I do not have is peace. But God says, I've given you peace, regardless of what your bank account says, regardless when you roll over and see your spouse and say, this is not working out right now. And I thought it was a joke. I need to say this. Me and Amanda were sitting apart. We're fine, all right? So I didn't know. When we sit separate, I'm like, I didn't let them know. We're good. We're sitting in different places, all right? So anyway, That was random. All right. That God offers you and me peace, but we must choose to step into it. We want God to do the miraculous. We want God to heal our marriage, to heal our family, to heal, to see the things. We must step into a place of surrender saying, God, I choose you. Peace on earth, the one that God is pleased with, the one that God has chosen. God has chosen you. Will you receive him? See, some of you today are sitting here and saying, I don't feel like I have peace with God. I feel so much guilt. I feel much shame. I struggle when I come to church. I don't feel like I'm good enough. I don't feel like, and let me tell you something. God has already chosen you. Romans chapter 5 and verse 1 says this, therefore, since we've been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. See, what we want the bells of Christmas to ring is that peace on earth. Everyone can be at peace with God. And it has nothing to do with how good you are, how many times you are a good boy or a girl, how many times you don't curse, or how many times you don't cut people off the road. It is about accepting what Jesus Christ did for you. It is stepping into it. Let me make it even more practical. You know what it looks like to accept God's place, position of peace? It is to actually with your mouth say, you know what? I feel stressed about this. I don't like where I'm married yet. It's my fault. It's her fault. It's whoever's fault. I don't like this situation. I'm confessing. Remember, I am speaking out what you've already spoken, that God, you have promised me peace, that you can bring dry bones to life. That's another way, that's the story of Elisha in the Old Testament, when he looks over a valley of dry bones and God says, can you think you can bring those to life? And Elisha says, only you can. Oh, it's Ezekiel, right? Sorry, Ezekiel. And he looks over the dry bones and he says, only you can, God. And God speaks and brings dry bones to life. This is the God that says, I have come near to you. This is why we can have peace with God. We can have peace in our life because he is that same God. But we must step into a place. We must speak it out loud. Brennan, a couple of weeks ago, spoke on prayer. And one of the things he said about prayer is we must speak out loud what we are praying. There's power. There's life and death in the power of the tongue. That's why when the New Testament, Jesus said, you have faith to move mountain. You know what he says? If you say to that mountain, move. There is something important. There is something supernatural. There is something spiritual. When we speak out loud the promises of God, this is confession. I speak peace over my marriage. It may not look like it at the moment, but God, you promised to give me peace. You want to restore this, so I'm going to step into this place. I speak peace over my children. I speak peace over the work. I speak peace over my finances. It may not look it, but my circumstances do not determine the peace that God's promised. In January, we're going to start a series called What If? If you're a Marvel fan, it is a little nod to a series that came out, but it's something greater than that. It's taking the promises of God and asking the question, what if you really believe what God said? What if you really believe that God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you? What if you really believe that? What would your life look like? What if you really believe that there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus, and because you belong to him, the life-giving spirit has freed you from the power of sin and death? What if we really believe that? Because the truth of the matter is, many of us are raised in church and heard about it. But the fact of the matter is, we don't step into it. We don't say, yes, God, I'm confessing. I'm saying this is what you said, and I will step in and believe it. Let my feelings and let the circumstances change, but I'm going to step into it and say, God, I believe it. Because what if we just believe this? I'll tell you what would happen. Our life would drastically change. The power of God flowing through us would change our world. It would change our marriages. It would change our children's lives. It would change if we stepped into the belief when God said it. We said, what if I believe that? Today, the bells of Christmas ring, peace on earth. Where is there no peace in your life? The first step, literally, the first step you must take today is start speaking God's peace over that circumstance. Out loud, today. Be Because he, as we learned earlier, is the Prince of Peace. He has authority to give us peace in all of our circumstances. Because it's interesting. You know what's interesting? Because when we access and understand and step into peace with God, we can then have peace within ourselves. And when we're at peace within ourselves, listen to me, we are then able to have peace with others. You cannot convince me otherwise that every conflict externally I have with others, ultimately because of the internal conflict me or the other person have, or both. Let me say that every external conflict you have with someone else in this world is ultimately because of a conflict that you have inside of you or they have inside of them. It is because you're not at peace with inside. And I find peace inside when I understand that God's already spoken over me peace. That he says, you are my child. I love you. I'll never leave you or forsake you. That you have accepted me, not because of what I've done, but because of Christ's righteousness and his death and resurrection. So that I have peace with you. I can now have peace within, that God is near. And I don't want to go there long, but man, just that phrase, God is near. We hear that so many times in church. But the God that created the universe, the God that brought dry bones to life, the God who split the Red Sea says, I am near you. I love you. I am here for you. I sing the song saying, resurrection power is flowing through my veins. The Holy Spirit, if I accept Jesus, I not only have God near, I have the Holy Spirit dwelling in me. That there is nothing in him that I cannot navigate. Because of his power. Peace within. And when I have peace within, I begin to have peace with you. I thought about it, I was speaking in first gathering, I thought I probably should have rearranged this message because this is going to be kind of the stepping on toes part, right? Should have landed with ended with inspiration, but I'm going to end with stepping on toes. You ready to hear it? If you are a follower of Jesus, there is no room, there is no place that you should not have peace with others. I'm not saying you be best friends. I'm not saying you have to be buddy-buddy. But if you're not at peace with others, then you are not understanding the peace that God's giving you with him and the peace within inside yourself. There is no room. In fact, Scripture says if you want to come give a sacrifice to the temple and you realize that someone has something against you, it isn't even your fault. Somebody else is mad at you. You know what Jesus said? Lay that down and go make it right with them and then come back. That's powerful. Look, if somewhere in Christendom, we thought we started being against stuff and we got to stand and make fights. Let me tell you, God said, I came to give peace and you as people need to be a people of peace. Pursuing peace with the people around you. I can't get that many peas out in one time. I'm sick and tired of Christians being the ones that are dividing and fighting, not just in our world, which it should be. We should be the leaders of peace in this world. The God of peace came and made peace with us. He gives us the right to be at peace with ourselves with him. We should be the proclaimers of peace. And according to Hebrews chapter 12, we should be the pursuers of it. We should with all diligence seek to be at peace with the people around us because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Y'all with me? And it's about time we stepped into the calling that God's called us to. Hebrews chapter, we're going to read these verses. Work at, and other translations, pursue. It means with everything you've got, you seek out peace with others. Two caveats. One, may the person you're seeking will not receive it. That isn't up to you, that's up to them. They make their own struggles, because when we're without peace, we have no joy. Right? They'll deal with their own things, but you must seek peace. Second of all, in the caveat is, it doesn't mean you if they were abusive or they're in a situation they've hurt you, it doesn't mean you put yourself back in that situation. You can pursue peace and not be friends, but you've got to be in a place where you're forgiveness and move forward. Y'all with me? All right? Work at living a peace with some people. With the ones you like. The ones that got the money. The ones that make you feel good about yourself. The ones that act like you, look like you, believe like you. Does it say that? As a follower of Jesus Christ, if you claim to be a follower, then he says you will pursue peace with everyone. Work at living a holy life. Isn't it interesting? He packs those together. People say, I'm holy, and they're out there beating and cutting down and being mean. They're not living a holy life. For those who are not holy will not see the Lord. Verse 15. Look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Isn't that true? When I'm not giving forgiveness to others because I'm not really receiving the grace that God's already given me. When I'm not willing to give you grace, I have forgotten the grace that God's given me. My toes are stepped on today. Now watch this. Watch out that no poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you and corrupt many. The writer in Hebrews is saying, look, pursue peace at all costs because God of peace has come to restore you. So you must go and restore it with others. Seek it all out because here's why. If not, this poisonous root of bitterness, pride, anger will rise up and choke you from the inside. We all been there, have we not? I mean, come on. How many nights have you stood up going, next time I see that person, I know exactly what I'm going to say. Am I the only one? Man, I wish I could have said that. You know what? They think I'm going to make sure next time I see them, I'm going to put them in their place. You know what's happening? This ugly root that's strangling our life begins to eat us. And what's crazy is, it says, look, not only will it trouble you, it'll corrupt many. My unforgiveness, my unwillingness to seek peace with the people around me not only affects me, but people around me. We all seen that, have we not? How about I've seen it in the church? Man, gossip, fighting, division, bitterness, jealousy. There's no quicker way to fracture the body of Jesus than through this. I know. I wish I could end it with you. But here's the thing. We must pursue this because what that bell rung so many years ago and what the angels proclaimed in the beginning, peace is given to man through Jesus Christ. So here's my thing. Today, receive it. Receive it. I don't know where your life's at. I don't know what stresses you have. Look at me, everybody. I don't know what in your at school, with your spouse, with your friends, with your finances, with coworkers. I don't know where the stress and fractured of peace is at in your life. But today, through the word of God, I say, claim the peace of God that he's promised you. Step into it today. Speak it over your fractured places. And let him do the work. Because when we understand that God's near and we have all his power and he is here with us, it changes the game. Yes, last night I saw my neighbor. He was coming out. I was inviting him, by the way. I was inviting him to Christmas Eve. Hint, hint. So go invite your neighbors. So I was talking to him. He said, my father passed away this week. Man, first of all, that should be enough. We don't know what our neighbors are going through, do we? I see them coming out. Their family's coming out. They're getting in the car to go. I don't know. He lost his dad. And he said, I'm missing him, and I'm going to miss things about him. But I'm a follower. I know Jesus. I know where he's at. And that gives me, he said these words, this gives me peace. May we live in that peace. And finally, follower of Jesus, proclaimers of peace, with all effort, pursue peace with the people around you. Not just for you and them, but for the others. Because here's the end. The world does not see peace. And they look for it everywhere. Should it not be more evident? Should it be the most clearest? It should be the most clearest here in the body of believers. When the world's desperately crying, where is peace? They should see that Jesus' followers exude peace because the Prince of Peace has come and redeemed us. This is just not for us. It's for the world that's seeking it. May we live in peace. May we proclaim it and may we pursue it. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, man, through all my sputtering and spitting today, God, Lord, please take the scripture and the words that you spoke today about peace and may it, God, just grab a hold of our hearts. Right now, I just feel the Holy Spirit. If you have something against another person in this space, or in another space, I challenge you by the name of Jesus that you go and make that right. Do not resist the pursuing of peace with the people around you. Maybe it's a phone call. Don't wait. Do not wait. Maybe it's when you get over to service, you go and make a phone call right away. You forgive or you ask for forgiveness. Don't wait. Maybe you're sitting here today, I don't feel like I have peace with God. I come here seeking for God's approval. Let me tell you something. God already approves you. He loves you. Step into what he's already spoken over you. Step into the peace that he wants to give you. I'm going to ask you to do that right now. Right in your seat. Just talk to the Lord. Speak peace over your struggles. Speak peace over your marriage. Speak peace over your finances. Speak peace over your children. Right now, this is not like a little part for the sermon. This is you having a conversation with God right now. Speak it over right now in your seat. Say, God, I need peace in this area. I don't feel it. I don't see how it can happen, but that's not up to me. My only responsibility is to step into it and to proclaim it, to confess it. Lord Jesus, help us to understand the great peace you've given us. God, as we celebrate this coming of the Messiah, the coming of Jesus, the babe in a manger, may we understand that what he truly came to give was to give us true peace with you, within ourselves, and with others. I pray for any individual here is dealing with broken and fractured relationship, who's dealing with anxiety and stress. God, help them to let go, to not try to control, and to step into a place of confessing your peace in that circumstance. And God, you will move, as you always move, bringing life out of death. And I pray that we as a church pursue peace with each other. That if what is spoken about us is they are a people that loves, truly loves, that is the greatest thing they can say. That when they see us come in together, regardless of what we look like, smell like, believe like, act like, that we are one, that we are together in peace, may we pursue that. Guard against division, Lord. Protect us from bitterness. Lord, we need your help. We stand in celebration. The bells that ring of peace on earth. I pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen.
What a great Sunday, last Sunday before Christmas, where we celebrate Jesus' birth and that he came here on earth, Emmanuel. Okay, we've come to the part of the gathering where we talk about giving. And if you're a part of Radius, you consider this your church home. We just want to make sure you understand that there is a giving box out there, a wooden box, and you can always drop anything in there, cash or check. But there's also a way online to give at any time, which is radchurch.com/giving. You can give one time or you can give, have a recurring gift. So if you're a new friend, we don't want anything from you except to say thank you for being here. What a gift that you gave us to be here in your and having your presence here. I'm super excited because I get to see you again Thursday. Yeah. So Christmas Eve, Thursday night, 7 o'clock. Or 8 o'clock. It's a 45-minute time. We will have children's programs. We'll have for preschool and nursery. We will have care. Elementary, we invite them in here. We give them a little bag of goodies so that they can partake with us. But we think it's special for them to get to see you. And it's short enough that their attention stay engaged. So have a good week. See you Thursday.